So throughout my career as a philosopher of science, the Pittsburgh Center for Philosophy of Science has always been a kind of citadel, a place of collective, intense engagement with the problems of philosophy of science that have always interested me, especially for me anyway, the problems about the nature of space and time and the growth of scientific knowledge. So I got my start in philosophy many years ago, somewhat by accident. I actually took a class that I thought was a psychology class. Turned out it was a philosophy class, and I was hooked from that time on. Got very interested in epistemology, theory of knowledge, and became convinced at a certain point that the most interesting problems about the theory of knowledge, or epistemology, were actually being tackled in the philosophy of science. Questions about realism, the nature of scientific progress, objectivity, and so on. So I embarked on a PhD in philosophy of science at the University of Minnesota. And there were strong connections then, as there are now, between Minnesota and Pittsburgh. And as I moved somewhat away from generalist philosophy of science into the history and philosophy of science, and to some extent the history of philosophy of science, my connections to Pittsburgh actually increased, especially through the influence of people like Ted McGuire and Peter McComber, who are renowned for their work in 17th century figures that I work on, such as Galileo, Descartes, and Newton. And so when I had the opportunity to have a sabbatical, I was very excited to be in, to be accepted as a fellow, and it's been a wonderful experience. It's a remarkably collaborative place. It's friendly as anything, and extremely intellectually active and engaging. So it's been a wonderful few months so far that I've been here. In addition to the professors and sort of permanent residents here, there's a terrific group of fellows, as I call them, who have diverse interests but have been extremely supportive and engaged in my own work and mine and theirs as well. So it's been a wonderful intellectual friendship that has developed since I've been here, and that's been extremely rewarding. The city itself, I have to say, is a charming place. It's a beautiful city of neighborhoods and offers many opportunities for sort of getting away from the intellectual milieu from time to time. While here at the center, I'm working on two main research projects. One is a project I've been taken with for a number of years, which is the development of the concept of absolute time in the 17th century. So the major figures here are, of course, Newton, but prior to Newton, Descartes, Locke, Hobbes, Henry Moore, Pierre Gassendi, all play a major role in this quite remarkable conceptual transformation, whereby time had previously, through the Middle Ages, been thought of as dependent on motion. Following Aristotle, who said that defined time as the measure of motion with respect to before and after. In the 17th century, time was increasingly emancipated from motion and came to be thought of as a sort of a substance in some sorts in its own right. And there's a parallel development with respect to absolute space. And so I'm working on a monograph, I suppose, that's trying to track this remarkable development from the late scholastics through Newton. The other project, which is a new one for me, is on early American natural philosophy or science. So I'm looking at some figures, colonial pre-revolutionary figures, and the development of science in early America. And the development seems to be sort of from a kind of a standard natural theological project, which is grounded in ultimately theology, to what we now consider to be a much more quantitative scientific project. And I take some of the main figures here to be Cadwallader Colden, Cotton Mather, and Jonathan Edwards. And so it's a very interesting area that's not been given, I don't think, sufficient attention yet, and I think it offers some new interesting insights in 17th and 18th century science in a colonial context.